Well, a few years ago, I was talking with a friend who's been a Christian for about 25 years. And my friend was telling me how discouraged he was feeling, because during that whole time, he couldn't think of a single person he'd brought to know Jesus. And that wasn't because he'd never talked about Jesus. It wasn't that he'd been a Christian on Sunday, but undercover about his faith for the rest of the week, the sort of Christian chameleon syndrome. No, at university, he'd invited along his friends to the college Christian Union, and with colleagues at work, he'd spoken about Jesus. But the thing that discouraged him was the fact that he hadn't seen any tangible fruit from these efforts. And he looked back now over 25 years of being a Christian, and he remembered the keenness that he particularly had to tell people about Jesus when he was new to the faith. I don't know if you remember the late 1990s song by the Christian band Delirious. It had the chorus that goes like this. It said, I'm going to be a history maker in this land. I'm going to be a speaker of truth to all mankind. Talking about the role of Christians, spreading the news of Jesus. But for my friend, those words now felt somewhat hollow. Never mind being a history maker, how about one single person coming to faith? My friend was just discouraged that his evangelistic efforts had fallen flat. And I wonder, have you ever felt like that? I certainly have felt like that at times. And perhaps if you're honest, you feel a little bit like that today. Now here at Danbury Mission at church, in God's kindness, in God's grace, we've been in a time of church growth. Baptisms, moving to two morning services. And yet, wonderfully, although the church is growing, well, it might be that personally, this growth masks the fact that for you, your own evangelistic efforts feel a little bit fruitless. And if you're anything like me, it's so easy to feel discouraged or disheartened when it comes to evangelism. For example, when a friend drops out of Christianity Explored after coming only once. Or perhaps when you feel like you've been wrong-footed in conversation and you didn't give a very clear answer to someone's question. It's easy to feel disheartened sometimes. And this morning, this is exactly where our passage is going to help us. And if you can't relate to that feeling of discouragement or being disheartened, well, my hope and prayer is that this passage will show you how to speak to someone who is feeling that way this morning. This morning we are continuing our sermon series in the book of Acts. And as we've seen over the recent weeks, Acts is an historical book written about the unstoppable mission of the early church. And in Acts chapter 18, the gospel was gaining a foothold in Corinth. There's a map behind us. Corinth was one of the big cities of the day. It was in modern-day Greece. And Corinth was a city with a reputation for wealth and for sexual immorality. Think perhaps modern-day Las Vegas. And although the church was growing in Corinth, there were conversions, there were baptisms, well, the Apostle Paul faced real discouragement. Paul's ministry was rejected by many of his own people, the Jews. And Paul needed encouragement to keep going, not to give up. And don't we need such encouragement too, to not give up and to keep going? You see, in Acts, as the gospel message went global, it is easy to overlook how the gospel messengers felt in the thick of it. Sometimes they felt disheartened. They weren't superhuman, were they? And Paul's experience in Corinth is going to show you and I three things that we need to remember when sharing our faith feels disheartening. So the first one of those this morning, the first thing we need to remember when we might feel disheartened sharing our faith, is simply to remember, keep on speaking. Keep on speaking. Now, again, if you've been here during this series in Acts, proclaiming the gospel, the good news about Jesus, it's not a new idea by the time you get to Acts chapter 18. If you remember, the gospel is the best news ever, that Jesus died for our sins, rose from the dead, and offers us eternal life. And Paul quickly sets about proclaiming that message in Corinth. Have a look with me at verse 4. As was Paul's pattern, he starts off by speaking in the synagogue, testifying, verse 5, that Jesus was the Messiah. That means that Jesus was the long-promised king. The trouble was, though, this message was not universally popular. Some people didn't like the message. Verse 6, many Jews opposed Paul and became abusive. And so what does Paul do? Well, we're told he shook out his clothes in protest. And that was basically a symbolic way of breaking his relations with them. Imagine for a moment you've got a friendship group, and one member of the group says they're leaving, they're not going to have anything to do with the group. Well, it's a bit like them leaving the WhatsApp group, that sort of finality as they move on somewhere else. Instead, for Paul, because his message had been rejected, in Corinth, Paul now focuses his efforts not on the Jews, but on Gentiles. Gentiles are non-Jews. And so in verse 7, you see what Paul does is he ups sticks from the synagogue, and now he operates from the house of Titius Justus next door. Now just imagine for a moment that this building was the synagogue. Paul had been preaching here, but because his message had been rejected, well, Paul had to leave and go and start a new church meeting in Danbury Medical Center, just across the car park. Well, imagine how disheartening that must have felt for Paul to be in such close proximity to those who'd rejected them, as they all streamed into the synagogue every Sabbath and avoided them, as he saw all their car parking stewards pointing them in the right direction. Now, of course, this is not to say that for Paul there weren't some big encouragements too. After all, verse 8, the synagogue ruler and his family came to faith. Many Corinthians were baptized, but nevertheless, don't miss how disheartening it would have been for Paul to have been rejected by his own people, the Jews, who he dearly loved. In fact, it wasn't just disheartening. Paul felt afraid. Have a close look with me at verse 9. In verse 9, the Lord, referring to Jesus, speaks to Paul in a vision. What did Jesus say? Do not be afraid. Well, that gives you an insight into Paul's state of mind, how he was feeling. Paul was fearful. Don't be afraid, says Jesus. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent. Paul needed to hear this despite the baptisms, despite the church growth. Paul needed encouragement. Don't be afraid. Don't give up. Keep going. And that is still the message for you and I today. Keep going. Keep on speaking. Don't be afraid. And Paul needed to take that to heart, because in verse 12 we see that the Jews in Corinth made a united attack on him, trying to stop him. Just imagine for a moment the pressure piling up on Paul to stop speaking, to stop proclaiming the gospel. And so Paul needed to keep on remembering, to keep on speaking. And don't you and I need to remember that for ourselves too? Especially when we might feel pressure to stop speaking. Perhaps when friends might criticize us, or when voices in society might try to silence us. We need to encourage one another and to keep on saying, no, keep on speaking, keep going. And we need each other's help in that, don't we? Well, let's see what Paul did. Verse 11. Paul stayed on in Corinth for a year and a half, teaching the word of God. If you know anything about Paul's travels during this journey, to stay in one place for a year and a half, up until this point, that was unprecedented. He stayed there for a long time, keeping on speaking. He kept going. And of course, it raises the question for us, should we keep speaking when someone keeps rejecting the message? Perhaps you've had a friendship with someone for 20 years, and there's really been no sign of any interest in Jesus. Your friend changes the conversation every time you try and speak about your faith. Anything deep, and the conversation goes into deep freeze. Well, although our call is to keep on speaking, if I could put it like this, sometimes we need to change location, to focus our efforts on taking the message somewhere else. And you see that with Paul. When Paul was rejected in the synagogue, did he keep on speaking there until he was blue in the face? Well, Paul kept on speaking, certainly, but he did change location. In Corinth, he moved from the synagogue to the house next door. Something very similar happens in Ephesus in chapter 19, verses 8 and 10. Paul moves there from the synagogue to the lecture hall when he's rejected. He changed venue. Paul changed audience, but he kept on speaking. And sometimes we need to learn from Paul here too. It can be wise for us to invest more time and more effort into relationships where God seems to be opening doors rather than those relationships where the door is firmly shut. Can I say, it is a question of wisdom, and it certainly doesn't mean we should stop praying for people or completely ignore old friendships. No, not at all. But it is wise to pray and to ask yourself the question, am I wisely investing in the relationships where I can be most effective in speaking for Jesus? It's a good question to stop and to ask yourself. So firstly, this morning we see from this passage, when we might feel discouraged or disheartened in sharing our faith, we need to remember to keep on speaking. But secondly, we need to remember that God is with us. God is with us. Back to Corinth. When Jesus spoke to Paul in this vision, Jesus didn't just say, chin up, keep on speaking. No, no, no. He gave a reason. Verse 10, have a look with me. For, here's the reason. I am with you, and no one is going to attack and harm you, because I have many people in this city. Here, God makes a particular promise of protection for Paul for the duration of his time in Corinth. And in verses 12 to 17, we didn't read them out, you see there that God kept that promise. Because when Paul was opposed by this group of Jews and brought before Gallio, the Roman official in charge of the region, well, Gallio throws out the case. Incidentally, as an aside, Gallio appears in secular history, and historians can very precisely date the dates that Gallio ruled over this region, to 51 and 52 AD. If you're looking into Christianity this morning, can I say that the Bible is anchored in real history? It's not fairy tales. You can go and check it out. But back to the promise made in these verses. Jesus' promise that to Paul that no one was going to attack or harm him, well, can I say it's important to know that is not a universal one when it comes to sharing our faith. In fact, Jesus' teaching elsewhere makes that clear. No, when you read the Bible, you come to know that Paul was ultimately martyred, and that's been the story of the church throughout the ages. And for us, God doesn't guarantee that people won't attack us when we share our faith, whether that's verbally or emotionally or physically or spiritually. Nevertheless, the promise that I am with you, well, that is true for every Christian. Wherever we might find ourselves speaking, wherever we are. And that is what helps us keep going, to know that God is with us. In Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, Jesus said to his disciples, therefore go and make disciples of all nations. And what did he follow up by saying very quickly afterwards? And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. That is something we need to remember and to hold on to. Tomorrow morning, perhaps when you get to work, and you sit down at your desk, and you're surrounded by people who don't know Jesus, who aren't interested in Jesus. Remember, you're not alone. If you've recently become a Christian, and you have a feeling of being alone when you're surrounded by your old friends who share very different values now, if that makes you feel alone, remember, God is with you. If you feel daunted at the thought of trying to tell your friends what you were doing on Sunday morning, well, remember, God is with you. I am with you, says Jesus. The great Protestant reformer, Martin Luther, suffered much for contending for the faith. He once said this, "Of whom shall I be afraid? One with God is a majority." One with God is a majority. As Christians, we are never on our own. Jesus is with us. If you're a Christian here today, the Holy Spirit lives in your heart. And so we can pray to him that he will give us confidence to keep on speaking about Jesus, that we will remember that God is with us. But there's also a third thing this morning that we need to remember, and that is that making disciples is a team pursuit. Making disciples is a team pursuit. Why do I say this? Well, sometimes in our evangelism, in our efforts to speak about Jesus, we can feel disheartened because we think it's all down to us. And so when we don't see the fruit, when we don't see much difference, well, sometimes we can be tempted to despair. And this is where we need to remember that making disciples, speaking about Jesus, it's not a solo activity. It's a team pursuit. Making disciples is not like the 100-meter sprint at the Olympics. It's more like the 4x400-meter relay race, one person passing on the baton to another. It's often said that as we play our part in sharing our faith and making disciples, it's often said that we are individual Christians are like links in a long chain that God uses to bring people to put their trust in Jesus, that God uses to bring people from death to life. And as we all speak and play our part, we're like links in that chain. And we see that in our passage as God providentially brings other people onto the scene to help Paul. Firstly, if you have a look with me in verses 1-3, we meet Aquila and Priscilla. Who were they? Well, Priscilla and Aquila, they were Jews who had travelled from Rome. Let me show you on the map. There we go. They travelled from Rome to Corinth. In verse 2, Luke tells us that the Roman Emperor Claudius had made a decree ordering all Jews to leave Rome. And again, if you go and check secular history records, it's recorded there that there were disturbances among the Jews in Rome at the instigation of Christus, translation of Christ. Already at this point, the gospel was causing a ripple in Rome. And that's probably what left them to come to Corinth. They're Christians. And now Priscilla and Aquila, well, they host Paul in their house. They worked together as tent makers. Tent makers had something to do with working with leather. If you'll forgive the pun, you could say that Paul pitched up with Aquila and Priscilla. But puns aside, they were a great encouragement to Paul. You can see that in Paul's letters. Next, in verse 5, Silas and Timothy come on the scene. They come down from the north, they come to Corinth, they probably come with financial help, which means that Paul can now focus on preaching full-time rather than part-time. And then if you look down with me to verses 18 to 19, Paul, having stayed in Corinth for some time, travels to Ephesus, and he takes Aquila and Priscilla with him, and he leaves them in Ephesus to establish new churches while Paul goes off to Antioch, ending his second missionary journey. And whilst Paul is away traveling, well, Aquila and Priscilla play a vital role in the life of another believer called Apollos. Who was Apollos? Well, have a look down with me again, verses 24 to 28. Apollos was a Jewish believer, a Christian, who came to Ephesus, verse 24. He was bright, he was zealous, he knew his Old Testament. But there was a problem for Apollos, which is that although he taught about Jesus accurately, his teaching was incomplete. We're told in verse 25 that Apollos only knew the baptism of John, that's John the Baptist, and that means he probably didn't understand the role of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not going to go into that now, it's something you can talk about in home group. But seeing this problem with Apollos' preaching, what do Priscilla and Aquila do? Do they drag this guy out the pulpit? After all, speaking dangerously with only half the story can be quite dangerous. No, verse 26, have a look with me. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and they explained to him the way of God more adequately. In other words, they put their arm around Apollos and they give him some theological training. Why does this matter? Why is this episode here in our Bibles? Well, it's here, I think, partly because when Paul left Corinth, he must have wondered, what's going to happen to those Christians? What's going to happen to that new church, particularly given the opposition from some of the Jews in the city? I wonder for you, if you've ever moved geographically and you've left a church that you've been involved in, and when you leave, you think, what's going to happen to all those people in that church? Is God going to look after them? Well, now we see in this example that through Aquila and Priscilla's training, Apollos is then equipped to go back to Corinth. Verse 27, God brings Apollos to Corinth. And he now is exactly the right person to pass on, to take up the baton rather, from Paul. We read in verse 27, Apollos is now a great help. Verse 28, he vigorously refuted the Jewish opponents in Corinth. This little episode about Apollos reminds us that making disciples is a team pursuit. God uses different people with different gifts from different places to build his church at different times. Later on in Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, he says this, I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. And why do you and I need to remember this when we might feel disheartened sharing our faith? Well, we need to remember this little episode because making disciples doesn't all hinge on us. And if we think it does, well, we're bound to be despondent when we don't see immediate results. We need to remember the bigger picture of what God is doing. Making disciples is a team pursuit. We're all links in that chain when we're speaking about Jesus and pointing people to him. Let me illustrate this with a story from my own family. Let me tell you about my great-grandmother, Gertrude Gray, or Trude, as she was known. Trude was born in 1896 into a Suffolk farming family. And Trude was a committed Christian. She was baptized at 23. However, Trude's faith in Jesus wasn't shared by all her family. Her daughter and son-in-law fell away from going to church when they became adults. And none of Trude's three grandchildren professed faith as they grew up. Nevertheless, Trude prayed for her grandchildren, for each of them would come to know Jesus. And after many years, well, Trude's prayers began to be answered through Helen and Fiona. Now, Trude didn't know Helen and Fiona. She never heard of them. But Helen and Fiona were Christian pupils at Canterbury High School in the 1970s. And Helen and Fiona at this school invited along one of their friends to the school Christian Union. And that friend happened to be my mum. And as my mum heard the Christian message, well, she put her trust in Jesus and joined the local church. Again, fast forward a few more years. A few years later, my mum started working as a teacher. And she shared her faith with another history teacher in the school. And that colleague turned out to be my dad. Over time, he came to put his trust in Jesus. And as my dad came to trust in Jesus, well, the prayers of his grandmother, Trude, began to be answered. When Trude died in 1978, none of her three grandchildren were Christians. Her daughter and son-in-law were not going to church. Within a decade of her death, all three of her grandchildren, including my dad, had put their trust in Jesus. Trude didn't live to see the fruit in these relationships. She didn't live to see her grandchildren come to faith, but she was a vital link in the chain of how God brought my parents to faith, and it was ultimately through my mum and dad's witness to me that I came to trust in Jesus. I very much look forward to meeting Trude in glory. And for you and I now, when we might feel disheartened, discouraged, because we can't see the fruit in our own evangelism, well, we need to remember the bigger picture. We need to remember we have a very big God and that he is at work through our efforts and that making disciples is a team pursuit through which God is at work. And in that, like Trude, we're simply called to be faithful in the role and in the place where God has put us. Here this morning, as we've seen the dedication of Zach, we've been reminded of the great privilege to pray for the next generation, something we can all be doing. And at the end of verse 10, what does Jesus tell Paul? Have a look with me. I have many people in this city. Many people. Now, this phrase echoes back to the Old Testament, where my people referred to the nation of Israel. But now in Corinth, God's people included both Jews and Gentiles. You see that by the people who put their trust in Jesus in this passage. And now in Essex, while God continues to build his church, his people, from all the nations, and he does it even through us when we're feeling disheartened or discouraged. He does it through you and me. So when we feel disheartened in that task of speaking about Jesus, what do we need to remember this morning? Well, we need to remember to keep on speaking. Don't give up. And we need to remember that God is with us wherever we are. Whenever we speak about Jesus, God is with us. And we need to remember that making disciples is a team pursuit. And for each of us, let's pray that God will continue to build his church. Let's pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we want to thank you this morning for your word to us. We thank you that you perfectly know our hearts and our circumstances, our relationships, our joys and our struggles. We thank you for this message of encouragement for each of us to press on in sharing our faith. And so, Heavenly Father, we pray that when we might feel discouraged, when we might feel disheartened, please help us to remember, to keep going, to keep on speaking, to remember that you are with us by your Spirit, wherever we are. And help us to remember that we're not on our own. Making disciples is a team pursuit. So help us, Lord God, to play our part. And we pray that as each of us do that, that you would be at work through us to build your church. And we pray these things in Jesus' name.